Hi, this is Dr. Ben Finio with Cornell University, and in this video, I'll show you how to use a solderless breadboard. Odds are you'll encounter one of these if you're taking a high school or college level physics or electronics class. In contrast to printed circuit boards and protoboards, where the components are permanently soldered to the board, solderless breadboards allow you to easily remove and swap around your components, which allows you to easily and rapidly prototype circuits. Before you start using a breadboard, it helps to understand what's going on inside. Here I have a translucent plastic breadboard, and if we look closely at the sides, we can see these rows of what appear to be metal tabs on the inside. I'm going to pop some of those out so we can take a closer look at them. Here I have one of these metal strips so we can take a closer look. You can see that it consists of 5 individual clips, but it's important to note that this is just one solid piece of metal. So all of these clips are electrically connected to each other. So when you push something into a hole on the front of the breadboard, it's actually being grabbed onto by these clips. So for example, if I push the leg of this LED into the first clip on the left, it is electrically connected to the 4 other clips. Knowing how the clips are arranged inside the breadboard allows us to use the breadboard to connect different components and build a circuit. So remember that these clips appear in sets of 5. Each set of 5 holes in a row here is electrically connected to each other. That means that the lead of this resistor is connected to this lead of the LED because they're in the same row. There is a gap in the middle of the breadboard, and there is not an electrical connection across that gap. So this lead of the LED is not connected to this lead of the LED. In turn, this lead of the LED is connected to this jumper wire since they're in the same row. You can see how this gives us a path for electricity to flow through this resistor, through the LED, and then through the jumper wire. We haven't addressed these vertical strips on the side yet. We'll talk about those next. These vertical strips on the sides of the breadboard are called buses or rails. They are typically used to deliver power and ground and make them easily accessible from anywhere in the circuit. Now, since you see these in clusters of 5 holes, you might initially think that these are also only connected in sets of 5. However, if we flip over our transparent breadboard again, you'll see that these are actually connected with a single continuous strip, one for each bus. Going back to my circuit with the LEDs, this makes it easy for me to access power and ground along the entire length of the breadboard. Note that these are not connected side to side, so I do need to use jumper wires to connect them on opposite sides of the breadboard. You can now see how this gives me a complete path for electricity to flow from the positive terminal of the battery, down the positive bus on the left side of the breadboard, through the resistor, through the LED across the gap in the middle of the breadboard, through the jumper wire, back up the ground bus, and then through the switch to the negative terminal of the battery. Most breadboards come with labels and use a grid system to identify the holes. For example, this breadboard is labeled in portrait orientation with letters for the columns and numbers for the rows. For example, this would be hole C5. The power buses are also commonly marked with colored lines, red and blue or red and black, for power and ground. However, note that these are just labels. They do not affect the internal functionality of the breadboard. I could erase these lines or swap their colors, and the electrical connections on the inside of the breadboard would still be the same. This is just a matter of convenience to make it easier for you when you're connecting an external power supply, but you can still reverse the wires. Also note that breadboards come in many different sizes, and the labels may vary slightly. For example, here is a larger breadboard that is also labeled in portrait orientation. But here's a larger one that is labeled in landscape orientation, with letters for these longer rows and numbers for the columns. Don't get confused, because in this case, it's the columns that are electrically connected. Finally, here's a smaller breadboard that doesn't have labels at all. Again, in this case, the rows are going to be connected in sets of 5. Now, as a student in a physics or electronics class, you will frequently be given a circuit diagram, for example, in the instructions for a lab, and it will be up to you to translate it to the circuit on the breadboard. This is easier to do when all of the components in the circuit only have 2 leads, and the physical component matches up pretty well with the circuit's symbol, like this resistor and the symbol for the resistor. However, you do have to be a little careful because there is always more than one correct way to wire the circuit. For example, here I have arranged the resistors and LEDs so they are physically in the same orientation and layout that they appear in the circuit diagram. However, I can take this LED and rotate it by 90 degrees, and you can see that I've added an extra jumper wire over here, and this LED will still light up. So this circuit is electrically equivalent to this one, even though the physical layout is no longer the same. So as you start building larger and more complex circuits, you'll want to plan this out in advance to make your circuit as neat and organized as possible. This will make debugging much easier. There are a variety of tips for doing this. For example, color coding your wires. Black is commonly used for ground and red is used for power. And keeping your wires as short and tight to the breadboard as possible. So for example, here I have cut these wires so they are just barely the length I need to make these connections, whereas this wire is much longer than I need it to be and it's sticking up. That can get very messy as you add more and more wires, and you generally want to avoid it. Where you really have to be careful is when you get to more advanced circuits with components that have more than two leads, because you will frequently run into things where the circuit symbol, or what you would use when drawing a circuit diagram, looks very little or absolutely nothing like the physical thing that you would put in a breadboard. So I have three examples here: a transistor, an operational amplifier, and an AND gate. So the transistor comes in this little package with three leads instead of two, the base, the collector, and the emitter. So here's the circuit symbol, and then here's kind of my drawing of the physical package, which is supposed to represent this thing. So depending on which way you have this oriented or which way you have it flipped around, you could get the pins reversed. You have to be careful about that. And then the operational amplifier and the AND gate both come in integrated circuit packages. So we'll talk about these a little more next. But in this case, for example, the op amp symbol is a triangle with these lines sticking out of it in different directions. And this triangle symbol is not at all what you would put on a breadboard. So the op amp comes in an integrated circuit with the pins labeled. So each one of these pins does match a pin or a line on the circuit symbol, but they're not in the same orientation or in the same order. So you have to figure out how you translate your circuit diagram to the physical layout on the breadboard. I'm not going to go through a detailed example of that in this video. It's just something to look out for. And again, the AND gate is just one more example of that here, where here is the symbol for a single AND gate, and this integrated circuit actually comes with four AND gates inside it. So depending on how many AND gates your circuit uses, you would have to figure out how to wire this circuit in your breadboard. I have seen students make that mistake where we ask them to sketch how they would lay something out on a breadboard and they draw this triangle op amp symbol on the breadboard. That is incorrect. Make sure you're thinking about the actual physical component as you would build the real circuit. Since we mentioned integrated circuits, let's go back and briefly revisit this gap in the middle of the breadboard. You will find out that that gap is perfectly spaced such that circuits in a dual inline package like this one will fit straddling that gap. So you can get the pins. You might have to bend the pins in slightly, just a little bit to get them to fit, but the circuit will fit across that gap perfectly. And then remember that there is no electrical connection across the gap in the breadboard. So this means the pins on this side are isolated from the pins on this side. So what you don't want to do, and again, I've seen students make this mistake, is put the entire circuit over on one side of the breadboard or the other. Because remember, each set of these five holes is connected. So now if I've done this, I've shorted this pin to that pin and so on. So that is definitely a good way to fry your integrated circuit depending on the connections. So always put integrated circuits if you're using them across the gap in the middle. Finally, a quick note about the most common mistake I see students make with a breadboard. It is very common and very easy to just have a wire or a pin off by one row, and that can prevent your entire circuit from working. So I will very frequently have students call me or a TA over to their lab bench and say, "It's not working, something's wrong. We swear we have double-checked our wiring three times. It matches the diagram. Everything looks like it should be working." And then we take a closer look and we find just one wire that is misplaced. So for example here, this is the same circuit I've been working with the entire time, and previously all three LEDs were lit up. You might glance at this and say, "Oh, maybe that LED's burned out. It looks like everything's right." But if we zoom in and check really carefully, we will notice that this leg of this LED is in the wrong row. So see how it's in the adjacent row. It's not in the same row as this jumper wire. And remember that the holes are connected across the rows. They are not connected between rows. So there's no closed path for electricity to flow from this leg of the LED to this jumper wire. So to fix that, I would just go in there, move it over, and now the LED lights up. Except I yanked the battery pack wire out, so then it turned off. Which brings me to another point that is a common mistake, maybe not as common, but still frequent. Make sure you have your components firmly pressed into the breadboard all the way. So it's maybe not evident at first how deep these holes actually are, and this is more of a problem with younger students, but you might just kind of put something in there lightly so it's not actually pressed in all the way. And this can give you intermittent connections, so maybe a little harder to diagnose sometimes, but your circuit will act like it's working sometimes, and then you bump the breadboard or move something around and it stops working. So really make sure you push the parts down all the way into the breadboard so they're in there firmly. That'll give you good electrical connections and make it more likely that your circuit's going to work consistently. So there's more to it than this and more detail than I'm going to go into in one video. Just to name one example, you might look at this and say, hey, wait a minute, isn't that a bunch of parallel metal plates with a plastic insulator between them, and doesn't that make a capacitor? And the answer is yes. The adjacent rows on a breadboard do actually act like small capacitors, so there's something called parasitic capacitance that is usually not going to be a problem in introductory electronics labs. It can become more of an issue with higher frequency circuits, so something you typically won't need to worry about. You can melt breadboards. If you look closely enough at this one, you can see I had some short circuits on this one at some point that actually melted the plastic, so you'll have to be careful about that. But again, the information in this video should be enough to get you through most introductory physics and electronics labs. As always, I hope you found this video useful. If you have a question, feel free to leave a comment and I'll do my best to get back to you. You can also check out the rest of my channel for my other tutorial videos. Thanks.